Good morning. My name is Ben Borland, and I am one of the elders here at Canyon Hills. And whether you're watching online or here in person, we are so thankful to have you join us for church this morning. Before we worship, I have a few things I want to share with you. First, this is the final call for our Pacific Northwest Biblical Counseling Conference with keynote speaker Pastor Brad Bigney. This conference is Friday and Saturday and is going to be an awesome event for anyone who calls themselves a follower of Jesus. Just text the word conference to 56525 for more information or to register. Second, registration is now open for summer camp. Because of COVID restrictions, we won't be able to have summer camp out at the lake this year, but we're committed to teaching your kids about Jesus. This year, summer camp will be at Canyon Hills for elementary and high school students, and at a local venue for middle school students. Even though the venue is different, it will be such an incredible time for your kids to learn about the gospel. If you have kids fourth grade through high school, you can register for summer camp on the Canyon Hills app or at canyonhillscommunitychurch.com/camp. That's all I have to share with you this morning. And now let's worship our good and gracious God together.
All right. Well, good morning, everybody. We are super excited to start our worship service off this morning with a couple baptisms. We have Tom Katie here first. Tom, tell us a little bit about yourself. How long have you been coming to Canyon Hills?
Been coming here for a little less than 2 years. Was born in the Pacific Northwest here in Edmonds, and was raised Catholic and baptized as an infant, and then went to a Young Life camp about 40 years ago up in Canada, and just learned that a relationship with Christ is you know, how I started my relationship with Christ. It's not just going to church, it's building that relationship with Christ.
That's right. And you know, it's that relationship that we really are seeking after with Jesus Christ, and it's that relationship that really transforms us.
Absolutely.
So what changed for you? Here you are now getting baptized. What made the switch for you?
Well, coming here, we went through the membership class about 2 months ago, and it was kind of stressed that baptism is a great thing, and I prayed about it and decided that now's a good time to do that.
Well, praise God. This is an incredible step of obedience in being baptized as a follower of Jesus Christ, and we're so excited to be doing this together this morning. So, I have a couple questions for you, Tom. Have you accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior?
I have.
Excellent. Do you believe that He is the Son of God, that He lived a perfect life of obedience to the Father, that He died on the cross as a perfect sacrifice for your sins?
I do.
That He raised to new life and now He's alive today?
Yes, sir.
Great. And do you promise to live your life for Jesus every day for the rest of your life?
Yes, I do.
Great. Well, based on that profession of faith, it is my privilege to baptize you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. We have Ashley Sines here. Ashley has been coming to Canyon Hills just for a couple months. You grew up in the Christian family, though. And what changed for you recently where you wanted to become baptized?
I recently saw a sermon to text a number to be baptized, and I realized that I need to be responsible for my own relationship with God and not just have it be routine with my family.
That's right. Yeah. So often when we grow up in the church, our Christian lives can become routine, but it's so important to make it your own, have that relationship with Jesus Christ. That's great. Let me ask you a couple questions, Ashley. Do you believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God?
Yes.
Do you believe that He lived a perfect life of obedience, that He died on the cross for the forgiveness of your sin, that He raised to life and is alive today?
Yes.
And are you going to follow Him every day for the rest of your life?
Yes.
Great. Well, based on that profession of faith, it's my privilege to baptize you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Well, good morning, church. We are super excited to begin our time of worship with some baptisms. We have Miles Mills here with us this morning getting baptized. Miles, you grew up in a Christian home, but started living your life for yourself until a couple of years ago. Tell me what happened on a ferry.
Yeah, about 4 years ago, I was
pretty much asking myself, what am I doing? I'm living my life with one foot on one side of the fence, living for myself and the world. I was living my life for kind of Jesus on the other side. And I kind of had an epiphany, like, what am I doing here? Am I gonna go all in or am I not? And I chose to go all in and Amen. No looking back.
Yes. Praise God. Praise God.
And so now here we are getting baptized. This step of faith in front of everybody here, I have a couple questions for you. Do you believe that Jesus Christ is your Lord and Savior?
No doubt.
Do you believe that He lived a perfect life, died on the cross for your sins, rose again, and is alive today?
With all my heart.
And are you committing to live every day for the rest of your life for Him?
For sure. No going back.
Excellent. Great. Well, based on that profession of faith, it's my privilege to baptize you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And then we also have Bethany here, Bethany Barnett. Bethany, yes, excellent, some family and friends here. Bethany, you also kind of grew up in a Christian home, but then recently you've just decided to take this new step of faith in being baptized. What are some differences that you've noticed in this last year between your life without Christ and your life with Christ?
Yeah, I would say that this past year, for most everyone, has been difficult with COVID for me, and disappointments with like nursing school and things like that. But I just realized how thankful I am for what God has given me, like an amazing supportive family, friends, church family, the ability to be a nurse, graduate in a week. I'm just super thankful for what God has done for me this past year and throughout my life.
Mm-hmm. And an incredible testimony to see the hope and the faith that we have in Jesus Christ versus the rest of this world. What a great testimony of that. Well, Bethany, do you believe that Jesus Christ is your Lord and Savior?
I do.
Do you believe that He lived a perfect life, that He died on the cross for your sins, that He rose again and He's alive today?
Yes.
And are you committed to follow Him every day for the rest of your life?
For sure.
Excellent. Well, based on that profession of faith, it's my privilege to baptize you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Good morning, church. We're so excited because this morning we again get to just worship out of baptism and just out of what Jesus has been doing in the lives of people here at the church. So this morning we have Lily with us. And Lily, could you just tell us a little bit about how you came to faith in Jesus?
I have always went to church, but I have never really felt like holy, I guess. But one night I was in my room reading the Bible and I finally realized like what He has done for me. Like He died for me and I'm just excited to live my life through Christ.
Yeah, so it sounded like, right, there was nothing that you could do to earn that holiness, but you realized that Jesus did everything that you, on your behalf, by dying for you.
Yeah.
Wow, that's awesome. Well, Lily, do you believe that Jesus lived a perfect life, died on the cross for the forgiveness of your sins, and is alive today?
Yes.
And are you committed to following Him for the rest of your life, no turning back?
Yes.
Awesome. Well, based off that profession of faith, I baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Here is Tamara, and Tamara, tell us a little bit about what brought you here today.
Well, I've been saved since I was 19, which was a long time ago, but I was baptized as a child, and that really wasn't my choice, and so it's just been on my heart that I needed to make a public declaration of my commitment to Jesus, and so that's what brought me here today.
That's awesome, right? That's what baptism is. It's a outward profession of the inward change that Jesus has already done in your life.
Amen.
So amazing to have you here. Well, Tamara, do you believe that Jesus lived the perfect life, died on the cross for the forgiveness of your sins, and is alive today?
Yes.
And are you committed to following Him for the rest of your life, no turning back?
Yes.
Awesome. Based off that profession of faith, I baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit.
So cool.
Amen. Amen.
just the best getting to start our service with baptisms and getting to celebrate what the Lord has done in the lives of those around us. Our God is so good, and we're so excited that we get to worship Him with you guys today. So why don't you get to your feet with us? Philippians 1:6 says, "And I am sure of this, that he who began a good work in you will bring it to completion at the day of Jesus Christ." And I have been so encouraged by this week, that we have a God that finishes what he starts. Even when we can't see it in the moment, even when we can't feel it in the moment, we can trust and we can cling to this promise. So we can lean into his faithfulness. Mountain.
Wonder, can we sing that bridge one more time? And I know that I know you never fail. I know that I know you never will. Let's all sing this together.
And I know that I know you never fail. Yes, I know that I know you never will. Yes, I know that I know you never fail. Yes, I know that I know you never will. 'Cause you make mountains move.
You have been faithful. We have never seen you fail us. And that gives us confidence that you will be faithful. Because you're a God that keeps his promises. Lord, you promise to never leave us or forsake us, to always provide for us. And Lord, to complete the work that you have already started within us. Lord, maybe we never see that work completed here on earth. But someday, we have full confidence that we will see that work completed when we get to see you face to face in heaven. Lord, we long for that day. Lord, until that day comes, let us not grow stagnant in our worship, in our praise of you, for you are worthy, you are holy. Lord, we give you all of our praise. It's in your awesome and holy name we pray.
Face to face, there will be no more sorrow, no more hurting, no more distance, no more limits. We will be where we were meant to be in the presence of our Lord and Savior Jesus. Lord, what a hope that is. Lord, whatever we're facing, would we cling to that? Would we rest in that? We rest in this truth. Lord, we love you, and it's in your precious name we pray. Amen. Amen. You can have a seat.
I'm going to ask you to get your Bibles close by and get them open to Daniel chapter 6. But before we jump all the way in, we're going to take a moment this morning to pause. From time to time, there is a tragedy that occurs in the family of God that requires us to pause, to pray, to acknowledge that although most of us walk into the doors of church with smiles on our faces, there are those who are very much in sorrow. Last week, one of our just own beloved members of our church, John Huynh, was the victim of some very horrific violence that took his life. It was the epitome of evil. And John is survived by his wife, of course, his family, his sisters, brother, survived by a lot of friends, a lot of people in our church that knew them and loved them. And so we want to take a moment to just bow our heads and to pause and realize that when one of us is hurting, we're all hurting. I want to ask you to bow your heads now and pray with me. Jesus, you told us that you are the resurrection and the life, that whoever believes in you, though he die, yet shall he live. And Jesus, you said that everyone who lives and believes in you shall never die. Jesus, we love you. We thank you for that amazing promise of hope that you give to all of us. And we believe, God, that John is right now more alive than he has ever been. We thank you, God, as appropriate as the song we just sang to you, he now sees you face to face. And so, God, it's in that hope that we rest. It's in that hope that we find any modicum of comfort today. God, we confess that this kind of evil startles us, it shakes us, it wounds us. And yet, God, if it wasn't for your love and your goodness, we would have no way to understand it. So, God, we lift up Rumit, John's wife, and their precious family, parents, and friends. And we pray, God, that today in this very moment, they would begin to sense that you love them. That you love them, God, like you deeply love John. And God, you promise that what this world intends for evil, that you will use it for good. And we confess, God, that we can't see that with our own minds right now. We can't see that in our own heads, but we trust you that in some way we're going to look back on this and we're going to say, you did it. You turned it into something good. So, Lord, we put our faith in you now, and we pray you would grant us rest and peace as we trust you with our lives every single day. In the name of your Son, Jesus, amen. Amen. Moments like this remind us of just how evil evil is, but at the same time, it doesn't win because we're also reminded of how good God is. Amen. Well, if you're new with us this morning, maybe you're online, you're somewhere in the building, whether you're in this room or in our overflow rooms, we've been going through the book of Daniel, the Old Testament prophet of Daniel, verse by verse, and we come today to the halfway point. When we're done this morning, we'll be exactly halfway through the book of Daniel. Last week, when we came to the end of chapter 5, Daniel had just interpreted the handwriting on the wall for Belshazzar, the wicked king of Babylon. And the writing on the wall was God's pronounced judgment. God was pronouncing judgment on this king and pronounced him to be guilty of the highest treason, which was mocking the holiness and sovereign power of Almighty God. And that night, the prideful king would lose his life, and the entire Babylonian empire would fall without a fight to the much inferior king and empire of the Medes and Persians. Now, I give you that detail because I want you to know that the Bible is not some mythical story that a bunch of people made up, got together, and threw it into a book, and we called it the Bible. But this is historical truth. This is verified in history that these kingdoms came together and conquered. And the message that was very clear to the wicked king Belshazzar, the message that was clear to him is still clear today. The prophet Isaiah reminds us that it is God who sits above the circle of the earth and reduces the rulers of the world to nothing. The message is clear. God will not be mocked. And ultimately, he will crush those who refuse to repent of this spiritual mutiny, mockery. Now, you fast forward to chapter 6, where we find ourselves today, and we have a new king. There's a new king in town. His name is Darius, and he's now setting up a whole new empire government. Daniel's reputation as a completely trustworthy and responsible man with great integrity soon preceded him. And Darius was more than happy to inherit Daniel from the Babylonian government. I think Darius saw Daniel's resume on LinkedIn or something like that and decided, you know what, we're either going to get rid of or kill all of the old kingdom's empire's government, but this guy we want to stick around. And once again, now in his 80s, Daniel is being recruited to a pagan government job. Now remember, ever since Daniel and tens of thousands of his Jewish countrymen were conquered and captured by King Nebuchadnezzar when he was 15 years old, Daniel, now in his 80s, he's never gone to a Jewish school, he's never had a Jewish job, he's never had a Jewish boss, he's never worked for a Jewish company. But what a testimony we see through Daniel's life so far. We've seen that it's possible to be in a family or in a job or work for a business or go to a school where no one has much of a love for God or the Bible or the church, and yet you can live and do your job in a way that blesses and benefits your pagan boss or coworker or company while refusing at the same time to compromise your integrity and your devotion to God. Don't miss that. What we've tracked now for five chapters is that Daniel is living in a world that is very unsympathetic to his faith in his God, and yet he has remained faithful the whole time. Now, let me be honest and clear. Nowhere is it intimated that this is going to be easy or especially fun, and nor am I suggesting at all that just because you do a really good job and you stay faithful to God that you're going to be loved and appreciated. In fact, it is more likely just the opposite. And so that's where we find ourselves now at the beginning of chapter 6. Let's stand for the reading of God's word. We always stand because we believe this is actually God speaking. And God wants to speak to our hearts today. He knows exactly where all of us are, and he wants to speak into our hearts comfort and truth for the days we are living in. Verse 1, you follow along. It pleased Darius to set over the kingdom 120 satraps to be throughout the whole kingdom, and over them three high officials, of whom Daniel was one, to whom these satraps should give an account, to whom they should answer to, so that the king might suffer no loss. Then this Daniel became distinguished above all the other high officials because an excellent spirit was in him, and the king planned to set him over the whole kingdom. But then the high officials and the satraps sought to find a ground for complaint against Daniel with regard to the kingdom, but they couldn't find any ground for complaint or any fault because he was faithful, and no error or fault was found in him. Then these men said, "We shall not find any ground for complaint against this Daniel unless we find it in connection with the law of his God." And then these high officials and satraps came by agreement to the king, and they said to him, "O King Darius, live forever. All the high officials of the kingdom, the prefects and the satraps, the counselors and the governors are agreed that the king should establish an ordinance and enforce an injunction that whoever makes petition or whoever prays to any god or man for 30 days except to you, O king, shall be cast into the den of lions. Now, O king, establish the injunction and sign the document so that it cannot be changed according to the law of the Medes and the Persians, which cannot be revoked. Therefore, King Darius, sign the document and injunction." Well, when Daniel found out that the document had been signed, he went to his house where he had windows in his upper chamber open toward Jerusalem. He got down on his knees three times a day and he prayed and gave thanks before his God as he had always done. And then these men came by agreement and found Daniel making prayers and petitions and pleas before his God. Why don't we just stop right there? Let me pray. Father, I just ask that now you would help us to begin to see ourselves in this story, to help us to understand it and know how it applies to our life today. We ask that special request, God, of you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. You can be seated. Right away, what we see in verses 4 and 5 is the envy of Daniel's co-workers. This Jewish prisoner of war is being honored and promoted above them. And so they conspire to knock Daniel down a few notches. And to quote an old poet, he once said, "Envy hates the excellence it cannot reach." Isn't that an amazing description of envy? In other words, envy sees what it does not have and hates the one who has it. And that certainly describes Daniel's co-workers. They couldn't find any compromise in his work ethic or loyalty to the empire. They couldn't find any fault in his character because his integrity was irreproachable. And Solomon was exactly right when he wrote in Proverbs 10, "Whoever walks in integrity walks securely, but he who makes his ways crooked will be found out." Well, they couldn't find anything out about Daniel. There was no dirt on him. They were left with one option: come up with a scheme to make Daniel incriminate himself. And in verses 6 through 9, they came up with the perfect scheme. They tricked the king into making himself God for a month. The God of the Month Club, they just started. They said, "O king, declare yourself to be God." And then they tricked him into making everyone pray only to him for that month. You see, they knew how to stroke the ego of a king whose only loyalty was really to himself. But more importantly, they also knew how loyal Daniel was to his God. And in a strange way, this plot was a huge compliment to Daniel. They knew prayer was Daniel's source of inner strength and wisdom. And as I was studying this week, I was thinking, would anyone know that about my life? Would anyone say that about me or about you, that your prayer life is actually the source of where you find peace and comfort and wisdom from God? Would anyone know that about me? Would anyone know that about you? Well, these scoundrels were now trying to make Daniel's prayer life his Achilles heel. And I want you to see verses 10 and 11, because they're the best verses in the whole passage. When Daniel knew that the document had been signed, he didn't do anything. He went to his house where he had windows in his upper chamber, open toward Jerusalem. He got down on his knees three times a day and he prayed and gave thanks before his God as he had always done. And then these men came by and found Daniel praying and pleading before his God. You see, when Daniel found out about the new law Darius signed, I'm sure it was heart-wrenching. I'm sure it was confusion. I'm sure it came out of nowhere, just like a lot of life does, doesn't it? You're just going about your own business and all of a sudden something just comes out of nowhere. And a lot of times those somethings are not always very pleasant. But for Daniel, his daily habit was to take time to pray to God three times a day. Now, this isn't a formula. You don't see this happening anywhere else in the scriptures per se, but it was just his habit. And Daniel knew where to find God in moments like these because he met with God every day in prayer. And that terrible day wasn't going to change that. Now, listen to me. Don't be confused about Daniel. He had probably the second highest job in the empire, and no one had more responsibility or demands on his life than Daniel in this day. No one had more excuses to be inconsistent in his daily devotions with God than him. You know, for Daniel, he was too busy not to pray. He absolutely believed God was still on his throne. And so when we find Daniel here in verses 10 and 11, we find him faithful and fearless, with no worry about the consequences. He hears about this law that the king signs into law. No one's allowed to pray to anybody except me for the next 30 days, and Daniel goes home and prays to God. Make no mistake about it, faithfulness breeds fearlessness. Consistency breeds courage. And the opposite of this is also true. Faithlessness breeds fearfulness. Inconsistency breeds fear when it comes to our devotion to God. And don't you love verse 11? I mean, just see it again. It says basically, the end of verse 10 anyway, three times a day, and he gave thanks before his God, as he had always done. I love that. After all this, his prayer is thanks first. The law's just been passed. If you worship God or pray to God, you're dead. And what does he do? He goes home and he thanks God. Like, who does that? How do you explain that? And yet there's so much to learn from this. What if we all did more of this when our government threatens to do things that are ungodly? What if we all got serious about getting on our knees and just spending time thanking God instead of getting on Facebook and losing our minds? How different would it feel? Daniel had learned that thankfulness is the key in neutralizing anxiousness. It was the key to pointing his heart and mind upward toward God. Could Daniel have known Philippians 4, verse 6, do not be anxious about anything, really anything? But in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be known to God. I love that. This is a verse in the Bible you all are so familiar with. Don't be anxious about anything. All right, who wrote this? Like, was it anybody who lived in the real world? Yeah, it was the Apostle Paul, wasn't it? And he says, listen, don't let anxiousness rule your heart. Go to prayer and start with thanksgiving. And then bring your needs and requests to God. I love that. Daniel gives thanks because it's the key that unlocks God's peace. Thanksgiving is that kind of that spiritual deep breath that allows us to rest in the sovereignty of God, Philippians 4:7, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding. It doesn't make sense on human terms, but this peace of God will guard our hearts and our minds in Christ Jesus. Isn't that what we all desperately long for, to have our hearts guarded by the peace of God? Oh, Lord. In the insanity that is our world that we're living in right now, how miraculous would it be to have a bunch of us running around, a bunch of God's minions running around at peace instead of running around crazy? It's possible. Now look at verse 12 where we left off. It says, well, then they came near, these scoundrels, these co-workers of Daniel, they came near and said before the king concerning the injunction, O king, did you not sign an injunction that anyone who makes petition, who prays to any god or man within 30 days except to you, O king, shall be cast into the den of lions? And the king answered and said, the thing stands fast according to the law of the Medes and Persians, which cannot be revoked. Then they answered and said before the king, Daniel, who's one of the exiles from Judah, he pays no attention to you, O king, or the injunction you have signed, but makes his petition three times a day. And then the king, when he heard these words, was much distressed and set his mind to deliver Daniel, and he labored till the sun went down to rescue him. And then these men came by agreement to the king and said to the king, know, O king, that it is a law of the Medes and Persians that no injunction or ordinance that the king establishes can be changed. They back the king into the corner, and then they accuse Daniel of disobeying the king's God of the Month law, and their plot works perfectly. The king realizes what he's done. His ego has overruled his heart, and his so-called inner circle of advisors deceived him. He could see the gleam in their eyes. He can hear the glee in their voices. Their God of the Month club never had anything to do with their admiration or loyalty to the king. And now the king's most loyal, trusted employee was about to suffer his wrath because of his stupidity and his exaggeration of his own importance and power. Yes, they were diabolical, but ultimately he was to blame. And isn't this an axiom for life today? Our self-love and our overestimation of our own importance is often the cause of some of our greatest stupidity and worst decisions. Sometimes we can get so full of ourselves, we could think we're so deserving of everything we want. Everything we think is right for us, regardless of others sometimes, that we start making choices and decisions that wreck our careers, can wreck our marriages, our relationships, our families, our friendships. We make decisions that could destroy our testimony, bankrupt our faith, financial disasters, divided churches. All are the fallout, many times, of the self-aggrandizement that we human beings have a tendency toward. You see, when you eliminate God from your life, you're only left with making yourself God, really. And that is the first step towards self-destruction. And so the king is embarrassed. He's distressed. He couldn't sleep. He couldn't eat. He couldn't be consoled. He couldn't rescue Daniel, his trusted friend. He makes this bed, and now he can't get out of it. Look at verse 16. And then the king commanded, and Daniel was brought and cast into the den of lions. The king declared to Daniel, may your God, whom you serve continually, deliver you, Daniel. And a stone was brought and laid on the mouth of the den, and the king sealed it with his own signet ring and with the signet ring of his lords, that nothing might be changed concerning Daniel. And then the king went to his palace and spent the night fasting. He couldn't eat. No diversions were brought to him. There was nothing that could cheer him up, and he couldn't sleep. His sleep fled him. Wow. What's interesting to me is they bring Daniel to the king, and no defense comes from Daniel's lips. He's the second or third highest ranking official in this entire empire, and yet he never pulls rank. Daniel makes no plea for his forgiveness, no apologies. He's guilty, and he's okay with it. As David Jeremiah said, Daniel would rather spend time with the lions than miss his time with the Lord. Well, into the lion's den he goes. And the king here practically prays for Daniel, not knowing it. He says to Daniel, oh, the God in whom you continually serve, I pray he would deliver you. The king knew God had rescued Daniel from death many other times. The king knew that Daniel's God was very, very different than all the made-up gods of their man-made religions. He knew this one God of the Bible was different. And the stone was rolled over the entrance, and the king's seal was put on the stone, indicating that there was no one on earth that had permission to go in and rescue Daniel. For Daniel, there was no way out. And then look at verse 19. At daybreak, after being awake all night, the king arose and went in haste to the den of lions. As soon as the sun came up, the king runs to the den of lions. And it says in haste, and it's a word that describes knocking anyone and anything out of the way to get to said destination. You think he just jumped up, he's in his PJs and his robe, and he's running to the thing. And any of his servants, anybody in the way, he's just doing this. He had one thing on his mind, and that's what it meant. He's going to the lion's den. And then look at verse 20. And as he came near to the den where Daniel was, he cried out in a tone of anguish. The king declared to Daniel, "O Daniel, servant of the living God," that's the second time he's called Daniel that, "has your God whom you serve continually been able to deliver you from the lions?" I like that. "O Daniel, servant of the living God," the thought that came into my mind was this: oh, that would be the epitaph of, or on every Christian's gravestone. Wouldn't that be something? Cemeteries filled with gravestones of Christians. Here lies a servant of the living God. This pagan king is testifying to Daniel's faithfulness. Look at verse 21. Then Daniel said to the king, "O king, live forever." Okay, this is so awesome. Remember, this is the king who signed the ridiculous decree into law. This is the king who had him thrown into the lions. Who answers the king this way? Who does that? Daniel maintains his dignity and his respect every step of the way. It's so inspiring. How does he do that? How does he answer, "O king, live forever"? Maybe he found compassion for this self-absorbed egomaniac. Maybe it seemed to Daniel that the king was genuinely remorseful for what he did. Maybe Daniel was understanding because the king was so deceptively manipulated. Or maybe Daniel was so overwhelmed by the hand of God's mercy in his own life that he was filled for love for his enemy. Whatever the reason is, I can't fathom. I'm confessing to you right now, I would have yelled something much different up to the king. "Hey, Steve, servant of the most holy God, are you okay? Why don't you come down here and find out for yourself? Hey, wake up, you guys, lunch is coming." That's what I would have done. I'm just confessing, that thought, "Oh, live forever, O king," the one who just threw me down here, would not have probably come across my mind, unfortunately. Look at verse 22. "My God sent his angel." This, he's answering the king now. My God sent his angel and shut the lions' mouths, and they have not harmed me because I was found blameless before him and also before you, O king. I have done nothing wrong. I have done nothing to harm you. So he testifies, God sends an angel, shuts the lions' mouths, and he says, this angel from God found me to be blameless. Translation, my faithfulness to God was not compromised. And not only that, O king, I've never done anything to harm you. And then verse 23 tells us that they pull him out of the lion's den and they find no scratches, no teeth marks, no torn clothes, no lion slobber on his face anywhere when he came out. And then verse 24, this story turns on a dime and it becomes brutal fast. And the king commanded, and those men who had maliciously accused Daniel were brought and cast into the den of lions, they, their children, and their wives. And before they reached the bottom of the den, the lions overpowered them and broke all their bones into pieces. This king was ruthless. But don't miss this. Sometimes our sin can bring a lot of undeserved pain to our loved ones. Sometimes our self-love and over-exaggeration of our own importance makes us do stupid things, and we bring a lot of pain to the people we love the most. This is harsh stuff, but this was the reality of a pagan king. These guys, they were married, their spouses, their children had no idea what was going on at work with their dads, their husbands. And one day the door flies open to their home and the king's army rushes in and drags them off and throws them in. How horrific our sin can be. Well, verse 26, the king makes a decree that he says, everyone in my royal dominion, every person now must tremble and fear before the God of Daniel. I kind of laugh at that. The king makes another dumb law, but at least this time his heart's pointed in the right direction, right? The first time he says, I'm God, worship me. The second time he says, I'm God, worship Daniel's God. But at least he's kind of, you know, like I said, he's pointed in the right direction. And then he goes on to say, for this God is the living God, enduring forever. This God's kingdom shall never be destroyed, and his dominion shall be to the end. He delivers and rescues. He works signs and wonders in heaven and on earth. He who has saved Daniel from the power of the lions. Wow. What do you think about this? A pagan king singing the praises of our God because of the life of Daniel. Do you want that to be said about you? Wouldn't it be interesting if the unbelievers that you work around, or the unbelievers in your family, they may not believe in your God, they may hate your God and my God, but wouldn't it be unbelievable if they acknowledged that the way you live never compromises who you say you believe God is in your life? And wouldn't that be something if your children grew up to say that about you? Sing the praises of God because they watched you live in faithfulness to him. What about your friends? Your friends at school, or your friends on your team, or your coworkers at work. They may want nothing to do with your religion, your Bible, or your church, but if someday they think it or say it, one thing we can say about you, you walk the talk. Wow. Well, let me give you a few things to take home with you today. Okay, first, we'll all end up in a lion's den eventually. Do you feel encouraged? The truth is, Daniel was saved from the lions, but he wasn't kept from them. In 2 Timothy 3, verse 12, our Bibles say that if you love Jesus and you wish to live a godly life, you will be persecuted. The Bible's very honest about that. So we can expect the lions of opposition to be snarling all around us, that the Bible promises us that. In 1 Peter verse chapter 5 says it even more clearly, your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion seeking someone to devour. And sometimes it's family who hates your religion. Sometimes it could be your workspace. You're being watched by a boss or coworkers who are looking for anything to accuse you of, to condemn you of, to mock anything you believe. Sometimes it's a neighbor trying to bully you into flying the flags or planting the yard signs that represent their morals and beliefs, and when you don't, they shun you. It can also be our government or our schools forcing us to try to get us to obey man rather than to obey our sovereign God. The truth is, a godly life is excellent, but it can be dangerous. Just like a bright light. Good people are drawn to it, but so are mosquitoes and bats who are always trying to bite us. Jesus said this. This is the judgment. The light has come into the world, and people love the darkness rather than the light because their works were evil. We have certainly experienced that evil in our church family this past week. You see, these lions that are roaring, they're always roaring about whether or not we will obey the laws of God versus the laws of man. The lions that are snarling all around us, it always has to do with morality versus immorality. The Equality Act, the rejection of science and truth when it comes to our God-given gender, and on it goes. The lions are roaring. And they're roaring louder than ever before. And the question I want you to answer today is, are you going to remain faithful? Will we take our stand on these issues regardless of the consequences? I'm not talking about making a big sign and standing over the freeway, you know, overpass and waving. And I'm not talking about standing up on your desk at work and screaming at your coworkers. I'm not talking about that kind of stand. I'm talking about you not giving in to the pressure of disobeying God in your own life, in your own family, you taking a stand and making sure your children and your family know God's truth and that it doesn't change. And no matter what goes on around us, we're going to continue to be faithful to God. We're going to continue to take our needs to God. We're going to continue to be thankful to God no matter what. That's the question. And I pray that's the answer. I want to encourage you to establish daily times of prayer and fill your prayers with thanksgiving and be serious about it, you guys. 1 Thessalonians 5, pray without ceasing because the lions are going to circle. But the difference a praying life makes is the difference between being fearlessly faithful or fearfully unfaithful. Let me give you a second point. Faithful prayer breeds courageous faith. For Daniel, his prayer life wasn't something of legends only. It was simply consistent. And what I've noticed over the years is that most Christians wait until they really need God's help before they start praying seriously. Have you ever noticed that? Usually wait till the lions are screaming before they say, I better start praying. And here's what's real. If you don't spend a lot of time with God when life is good, when the lions are resting, so to speak, it's going to be really hard to find God when life gets hard. We quickly find out that it's really hard to start good habits in the bottom of a lion's den. So establish those times of prayer. Now, have you noticed, I haven't commented or said anything about the angel who shut the lion's mouths. Have you noticed that? Some of you, that's the only reason you came to church today. Who is that angel, right? Most scholars believe that this is the same person King Nebuchadnezzar saw in the fiery furnace with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in chapter 3. And these same biblical scholars make a good argument that this person in the lion's den in the fiery furnace is Jesus, or at least an Old Testament type of Jesus. And this is the gospel according to Daniel, that when we put our trust in Jesus, death has no sting. Listen. When you put your trust in Jesus, death is no longer the worst thing that can happen to us. when we repent of our sins and put our hope in Jesus, our death has been conquered by the power of Jesus' resurrection. And that's why Jesus can say, if you believe in me, even though you die, you will live forever. Bad things do and will happen. So I'm calling upon you today to put your hope in Jesus, because he will never leave you or forsake you. Sometimes he rescues us out of the flames and out of the lion's den. And sometimes he rescues us after it. But as Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego said in Daniel 3, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us. He's perfectly able. But even if he doesn't, be it known to you, O king, that we will not serve your gods or worship the golden image that you have set up. Here's what they were saying. Our God is on his throne, and we trust in him. And the reason we trust in him is because he loves us so much, he sent his son Jesus to die on a cross for us so that we could be forgiven of our sins. And then he raised him from the dead so that we could also rise and live forever with him. And it's that God and his love and his power that we're putting our hope in. And so they looked at the king. Daniel did the same thing and said, I'm not going to be unfaithful to the one who loves me most and has done everything necessary for me to have eternal life. And so they remained faithful. And the purpose of these events being in the Bible is to encourage our faith that we too worship the same God Daniel did. If you do not believe in Jesus, I want to invite you today to humble yourself and say, okay, I've been my own God long enough, or I've been bowing down to golden images my whole life, and none of those give me hope. None of those give me peace. None of those give me forgiveness. None of those take away my shame or my guilt. None of those take away my fear. I'm going to put my hope in Jesus Christ, the Son of God, risen from the dead, alive forever, who died for me. And if you sense in your heart it's time, that God's got your attention, I want to invite you to text the name Jesus to this number. And when you do that, you're saying, I'm ready. Contact me. I want to take those steps of faith. And we will. We'll get a hold of you and say, hey, let's walk this together. Let's walk it out. If you truly do sense your need for a Savior, Jesus Christ is the only one who can do it. Let's pray. God in heaven, I ask with all my heart that many, if not hundreds today, here and all around the world listening to this message, that you would indeed, God, call unbelievers to yourself, and that your grace and love, God, would just fill them up right now, and that they would be overwhelmed that they have now and forevermore heard the truth. And I pray, God, that today they would step over that line and declare that they believe it. And we pray this in Christ's name. Amen. There are people up here right now who are so ready to pray with you. Maybe you've got some lions just growling at the door right now, and you're like, man, you know, will you just pray for me as I go about my week? And that's why we're here. You also may be sensing a great sense of urgency, like, okay, I need Jesus right now. I'm not going to wait for someone to call me or text me back. I want to talk to someone about that right now. That's exactly why we're here as well. Love to talk to you about that. God bless you. It's been an awesome day in church. Can't wait for next Sunday. See you then.